H.E.A.R.T.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today I'm here in like almost central Florida here. I had to drive a bunch of hours, or maybe an hour or two from like Tampa to get here to Lake Wales, Florida. And today I'm here at H.E.A.R.T. And this is the Hunger Education and Resource Training here. And one of the cool things is they do a training here, like a 15-week program that you can literally learn if you're gonna be like in the Peace Corps or do like some kind of cross-cultural service. And literally, you know, you come from a first world where we have running, you know, water and power and all these things. And literally you get to come to this village, which basically simulates, you being in a third world country and gets you ready for you providing service. And so I'm gonna go ahead and read off their little brochure. And if you guys wanna learn more about them, you can check them out at heartvillage.org. It says, situated on 40 acres in subtropical Florida, H.E.A.R.T. is the ideal place to prepare your heart, mind, and body for effective cross-cultural service. Live in intentional community while you set up residence in our simulated majority world village and gain skills in cross-cultural adjustment. Get your hands dirty in the gardens with the animals and in the appropriate technology center, acquiring the skills for addressing the needs of the poor around the world. Step away from the noise of everyday life and give God the opportunity to speak to you in new ways. Take the journey, be the change. And I really love what they're doing here. And actually the amazing thing is they've been doing this here since the 80s. You know, I'm gonna pretty much focus on the garden aspect, although I will show you some of the other aspects of this place as well. They offer many different programs. They offer a 15-week program, a full immersion. You could get college credit for this, a 3-week condensed version, an internship. And that's only if you've gone through one of the programs. You can actually work as an intern and like literally learn by on-the-job training. You can also go on a free tour. Free tours are by appointment. Don't just show up. Call them up in advance and make an appointment. You can come down and get a free tour. Everything I'm going to show you guys today, maybe more, maybe less. I did have to say that I did get an extended tour from Josh, the garden guy here. He's extraordinary, and you maybe will hear from him at the end of this episode. They also have independent study programs. So say you want to really learn about the garden or certain tropical fruit trees growing here in Central Florida, you know, you could basically pay $25 a day, and if you want to stay overnight, you could do that. So it's $25 extra for food and lodging. So for $50 a day, literally you could get independent study training and direction in any of the things you guys are going to be seeing in my video. So that's really cool. Like, not a lot of places do this, guys, so you guys should really value this. Of course, if you're in elementary or high school or whatever, you guys could, your teachers could call here for a field trip, and they do MAV groups, which is a Mission Awareness Venture. It's a program for short-term groups wanting the H.E.A.R.T. experience. Bring a group of 10 or more to the village for as little as a day or as long as 2 weeks. They also have kind of like different kind of camps here that you could probably rent the facilities out and do different kinds of classes or something like that, different kind of programs integrated into what they're doing. So anyways, with that, I'm going to go ahead and take you guys into some areas of the village here and show you guys their simulated village, what you might learn a little bit here, how you'll be eating here. But then more importantly, I'm going to go ahead and get into the gardens and share with you guys some of the things I learned that I never knew before here from Josh. And, seeing actual real-world examples in the gardens. So they've really kind of created a little village here that the students will come in for and live at for, like, you know, 15 weeks, like, you know, 4 months, and even go on field trips to other countries and other field trips in the area. I think they're going to Fort Myers later this week to see some Thai farm or something, visit some Thai farm. But and they set this up actually like you're in a third world country to basically prepare you to go to a third world country so that you don't just get there and you're like, oh my God, they got no power. They got no really real toilets. I'm headed back, man. So they set you up. They basically have like a latrine or like pit style toilets like over in the woods that you got to go to use. They have like buildings. They're just structures, right? There's no power, no electricity in there. There's no running water in any of the buildings. They just basically have like cots, you know, and beds for you to sleep on, and then that's pretty much it. I mean, it's just pretty much like, almost like you're camping, right? It kind of reminds me of being at a campsite that's even more primitive than like, you know, a kid's camp that you would go to where they actually have real bathrooms. So you're literally like going out in the sticks. That being said, while you're here, they will also feed you, diet based around the food that is grown here, primarily with other foodstuffs that they do import and bring in. as well as give you lots of classes. So real quick, I want to show you guys actually the dining hall and also the classroom to show you guys what we could learn. So part of the coursework the students will learn when they come here is basically just like cooking like primitive style, right? They basically have like 55-gallon drum bread ovens. They have rocket stoves. They have some kind of like skillet that they basically put wood in. It's all made actually realistically based on like I think a model down in South America where you put wood in, and then they have a skillet on the top that basically burns wood to heat the skillet. I mean, we all have like electric skillets and gas powered and all these things, but this is how a lot of the world lives. They just burn some like, you know, scrap 2x6s to basically work all this stuff. Don't worry, all the students don't have to eat the food from here, but they'll learn how to use these, because when they do get to, you know, a third world country, they will have to be cooking like this. That's of course if they want to cook. All right, so this is the main kitchen area where they actually make the food that's served here to the students, as well as the dining hall. And I'm gonna go ahead inside and share with you guys what they'll be eating, maybe later tonight. So definitely when you come here, you're gonna get a diet adjustment, right? Many people may be used to eating fast foods and highly processed foods. And here you're gonna get more of a real food diet. What is a real food diet? Well, it's based on foods that's grown here on the farm, right? This way the farm saves money. They serve the people visiting higher quality food, more nutritious food than they would otherwise be eating if they just bought foods. You know, here's actually taro root that they will be processing. They grow sweet potatoes, cassava. Here's some peppers that were broken off that they'll be cooking up and using into something. And actually, these ones actually aren't that hot. They have like onions here that they dug up. They have passion fruits, roselle. They can make teal. And here's all the stuff they've already prepared, like different kinds of cooked greens and some mashed up, tuberous stuff. They just actually harvested eggs. They will actually, harvest milk from some of the animals here, and also kill and harvest some of the animals for the meat, including the pigs. Now, here, this is like a non-profit, so I'd encourage you guys to donate. I think money is always good, but sometimes people donate whatever they got, like in case of this, right? Sometimes people donate food. They got donated beans, and check this out. People are donating Cheetos. So this is not necessarily a staple food here, but if it gets donated, they're gonna offer it and provide this to people that are in the program so they'll have options to eat, because not everybody wants to eat more of a traditional style diet, which I would encourage you guys to eat more of these traditional foods instead of the processed foods. Like, these are man-made inventions. One of the big challenges, in my opinion, in countries around the world is that they're getting our Americanized food imported there, and it's causing a lot of health challenges because this food is literally junk food. We call it junk food. We know it's junk food. Why do you still eat it if it's junk food? Junk food produces junk people, in my opinion. I mean, this is just full of calories, fat, sugar, salt, and oil. And likely GMO products as well. Not good for us, right? And so you guys are going to see what I think of this stuff a little bit later on. And if people don't eat it here, because it is donated, put it out. If people don't eat it, then it goes somewhere else, which is what I'm going to show you guys. And we'll stick this in my back pocket for now. Don't worry, I'm not going to eat it. All right, so what you guys can see behind me is basically the classroom building where the students here will come take classes, both behind the class, but also, in the real world, in the garden, they'll be having classes with like hands-on education. And I really think that's the value of this program, is like you get the hands-on education, especially on like, the different cooking methods that you're going to learn. And also like they have like, weaving looms and different things, and you're going to get hands-on experience how to do all this stuff. Anyways, I want to head into the classroom and share with you guys something real important that they have, up in the classroom to educate the students who's coming. So they got a cool post here that I want to share with you guys real quick. It's domestic techniques to maximize plant-based nutrition. And it says the World Food Program estimates that of the world's 795 million hungry people, 98% of them live in the developing world. 75% of them live in rural areas, mainly in the villages of Asia and Africa. And 70% of them rely on farming as their primary occupation. In parts of East Africa, the probability of dying for 1 to 5 year olds is up to 40% higher in rural areas. Therefore, it is clear that the world's most vulnerable families and children are in homes in rural villages, and they are farming to survive. Improve their health, we must improve them at home. And then it says, why plant-based nutrition? A large percentage of the world's hungry people are primarily vegetarians and even vegans, either due to religion or poverty. And I think they're using these terms in the sense that they're actually eating plants as the majority of their calories. Not necessarily that they may have an ethical view
behind it personally. In some cases, of course, yes. And that's my opinion interjected in there. Although some might find that a sad fact, the reality is that a whole foods, plant-based diet can produce the world's healthiest people, as a National Geographic reporter, Dan Wetner, found in researching the, quote, blue zones, quote, these are the five places in the world that not only had the highest concentrations of 100-year-olds, but also clusters of people who had grown old without disease like heart problems, obesity, cancer, or diabetes. Each location had a primary plant-based diet and other factors. So you talk about maximizing plant-based nutrition. And the other area of this that I really want to point out, because this also is very important to me, is that combating hidden hunger. Farm stew also promotes consuming a rainbow of fruits and vegetables. These are the most powerful tool to increase the micronutrients in the diet, thus eliminating the hidden hunger. There are over 5,000 beneficial phytochemicals in fruits and vegetables. Eating across the color spectrum will provide the body's needs for optimal health. Based on my research, I would also agree with this. I would disagree with 5,000 beneficial phytochemicals. Maybe that's 5,000 found currently, but they're discovering new ones all the time. And then the conclusion. We'll leave you guys a conclusion if you don't want to read all this stuff. Plant-based nutrition is a healthy, sustainable, and realistic for promoting rural health development. These simple techniques and Bible-based wisdom can transform lives of the most vulnerable of the world's families with the simplest ancient advice and affirmation given throughout the prophet. Build houses and dwell in them, plant gardens and eat their fruits, Jeremiah 29:5. So I mean, I would absolutely agree, right? Even if you live in a first world country and you're not in a rural area, we, as many people as possible, should adopt as dominant of a plant-based whole foods diet. I do not advocate a vegan junk food diet whatsoever. I do not agree with that. I do advocate a whole food plant-based diet. Does that mean you need to become a crazy vegan and strip in front of McDonald's and tell people to eat, no, not eat meat? I don't really care if you guys choose to do that or not. I'm not doing that. But what I do want you guys to do, I do want you guys to eat more fresh fruits and vegetables, whether you gotta cook them or eat them fresh. It's one of the most important things you guys could do to help not only yourselves, your health. That's how I've turned my health around, by changing my diet to a whole food plant-based diet concentrated around literally the best foods on the planet, the fruits and the vegetables. But also you can help the planet. It is much more energy intensive and resource intensive to farm animals, especially the way they're farmed in big animal agriculture in this day and age, right? It takes far less energy to produce food from plants than food from animals. Of course, the animals can be a part of a farm in a regenerative system. They may not be entirely necessary, like some people may lead you to believe based on what I've learned. But nonetheless, here's the thing, and it boils down, nutrition boils down to this. The more fruits and vegetables you can eat, and the less of especially processed food, junk food, whether vegan or not, right? You eat, the healthier you're gonna be. I want you guys to maximize your fruit and vegetable consumption and minimize your processed food consumption, and that includes, you know, processed meats that have salt in them and all these things, which are determined by the World Health Organization to be a probable carcinogen, or maybe it is a carcinogen. I always forget the terms they use. The other thing I want you guys to do is remember this. Every meal you eat, right, you have a choice of what you're eating, right? You can eat to help your body, help your health, help the planet by eating more plant-based foods, especially foods you guys could grow in your own front yard or backyard or farm or in any rural area, like I'll be showing you guys in just a minute. Or you can choose to eat more intensive labor, you know, resource-intensive foods like meats and animal products, right? Here's the thing. The more animal products you eat, the more it displaces, the less you can eat of fruits and vegetables, right? So I want you guys to get a nice balance, right? And I'll never tell you guys what that balance is. I would like to say that the balance should be, you know, as research has proven, you know, you must eat lots of fruits and vegetables and less than 10% of your calories of animal products, and you could live actually a really healthy life. The problem is if you eat too much animal products, right, you displace too many vegetables, and you're eating so few vegetables that the vegetables is not going to really, in my opinion, undo the damage that the meat is causing. Meat is a concentrated source of protein, concentrated source of nutrients, and can be helpful in certain situations. But eating too much of it, proven by science, is definitely not helpful. So eat as many fruits and vegetables as you can and minimize the junk food, the animal foods in excess, is what I like to say. And I'll leave it up to you to determine how much animal foods you like to eat. But you know, as proven by science, you want to eat less than 10% of calories of animal foods, and you know, you could still be healthy. And I just choose to get away from animal foods because I could not go through what it takes to basically raise an animal as a pet and kill it. Like, I couldn't kill my dog to eat them. And they raise animals here out on the site, and actually have students participate in the harvest of them, which I am in full agreement of. I don't like animals being hurt or killed, but I'm glad that, you know, the students are involved in the process so they see what happens. I mean, this is the literally the bloody truth of the matter. And some of the students, after going through the process, say, I don't want to eat animals anymore. And I mean, I would be shocked too if I had to kill an animal. I wouldn't be able to do it. I wouldn't want to do it. I'd rather eat 10 pounds of grass than 1 pound of animal, right? It's better for me, in my opinion, and also the planet, especially the psychological. You know, I think I would be damaged if I had to kill an animal. Oh my God, it'd be like heartbreaking. I wouldn't be able to do it. And you know, but you guys could do whatever you guys choose to do in your life. Anyways, that's the classroom, and I think that's about all the village I want to share with you guys. What I want to do next is actually take you guys out into the amazing garden where they're growing all kinds of tropical fruits, vegetables, more importantly, the perennial vegetables, and sharing with the students here how to grow them and help people in foreign, in, you know, third world countries, should they need to, you know, teach them different techniques on how to grow food and even advance them with knowledge that I was not even aware of until I showed up here today. All right, so now we're gonna go ahead and take you guys into the garden, and this place is extensive. I can't remember all the places that Josh took me earlier on the tour, but I'll try to point out as many of them as I can, as much time as I have until it gets dark here. I've learned so much today, it's been so educational. I'll encourage you guys, if you guys are in the area, to come out for a tour. Once again, call in advance to schedule a tour. You cannot just drop in and do a tour because, you know, they have classes going on, they have all kinds of things, and you know, they need to schedule you in so they, you know, expect you, because they might be in the middle of a class and all this kind of stuff, all right? In addition, the other thing that's really cool is they actually have a plant nursery inside that you guys are gonna get to see, that if you guys are looking for some of the rare plants, some of the plants that I'll be sharing with you guys in this episode, you know, some of the different perennial vegetables, even fruit trees, you know, they have affordable plants and rare plants that pretty much are pretty hard to find in many cases available for you guys. Now, the nursery works is open all year long, but honestly, the best time to come is probably about in April, because they get, in the wintertime, they kind of take the nursery off, so there's kind of just the stragglers, whatever's left in there. And then come March, they really get it up to speed, and by April, it's basically a packed nursery with all the plants you would ever want. So I'd probably make an appointment to come to the nursery and, you know, and then load up on plants, bring them home and plant to your heart's content, and you'll basically have a nice food forest in your yard with some of the same plants, you know, that you're learning here about today. Anyways, now let's head down into the garden. So I really love the entrance to the garden. Not only does it create a nice like pathway or roadway, but it also shows like a lot of different things growing and gives examples of how literally in a landscaping environment where it looks pretty, it could be quite functional as well and provide lots of food. So they have like Thai, you know, pepper leaf to eat. They have like bananas growing above. They have a nice, you know, hot peppers growing. They have like, I think, turmeric or ginger. They have like sweet potatoes on the bottom. They have longevity spinach there. They have the chaya tree there, which is good for edible cooked greens. They have like different fruit trees. They have edible cactus, like Suriname cherries, I believe. They have the edible tubers, cassava roots right there. Like so many things, like just growing in this one alley. And this is kind of like, they talk about this on the tour. Anyways, we're gonna head into the standard raised bed garden where they have the annual plants. Most of this whole place is planted out in perennials, which is something I think everybody here in the central Florida and even like, you know, along the coast, southwest or southeast coast should be doing. They should be doing more perennial style crops that could handle, you know, the hot summers here. You know, normally the gardening season is thought as the winters, because that's when you could grow tomatoes and all the common things that they're used to up in the north. But really the summertime is the time that you want to peek out and grow lots of food, and that's where you really have to grow some of these perennials. I'll talk about the perennials later in the episode, but first I'm actually going to hit up their annual garden, which they're actually just getting planted for the season, and share with you guys how they're so successful here in central Florida, where literally the soil is sand. All right, so I'm not joking, you guys. I could be on the beach right now in Hawaii. Look at this. Look at this nice sand. I mean, this is just like sand. It's like nice white sand. They even have nicer, whiter sand than the stuff I'm showing you guys right here. And actually, some of the sand in Hawaii's beaches, not even as nice as the sand here in the middle of central Florida. They got some really nice, white, very thin-grained sand. And that's, you know, while it's good if you're on a beach because it doesn't hurt your feet to walk on. You could probably walk around barefoot here, but don't do it. Walk around with shoes. This is definitely the worst thing possible probably you could have for growing trees and edible plants, especially annual vegetables that usually like a bit more fertility than just the sand could provide, unless it's an area that had like trees and things growing where there'll be a layer of topsoil and composted woody materials and organic matter. Most of the whole property pretty much looks like this. All right, so now I'm in the raised bed vegetable garden area. This is their annual production, right? When students are off, not here, and it's summertime, then they're planting basically cover crops or other crops that can survive during the hot summer. And so this year they did a lot of trials with different kinds of sweet potatoes. You know, they're growing a lot of different kinds of sweet potatoes to find out which exactly specific variety of sweet potato will produce the best with the minimal pest pressures and also produce large tubers, you know. And depending on where you specifically live in the whole country, right, that may be different. One variety of tuber may do good for you and one variety may not. And, you know, so what they're doing is they're planting all these different kinds and finding out which exact variety will work well here for the, you know, for the exact, you know, light exposure they have, for the nematodes, you know, they're going to have in the soil, and for the watering that they do. And they've been finding some winners, and they continue to experiment. And that's something I want you guys to never stop doing. Whether you're trying to help somebody in a foreign country and you have one variety of sweet potato, try to source other ones. Maybe the next variety or a different variety they never grew before will do better. Maybe it'll do worse, but if you grow better, you could increase, you know, the food that a developing country could have by simply giving them a different variety of sweet potato that could double their yields potentially, right? And so do trials, right? Very important. And likewise, for you guys growing at home that have like a standard residential spot like I do, right? I want to get the most production out of my small 10,000 foot lot or whatever it is, right? And that's why it's important to continue to do research, whether it's on your own. I do trials every year myself, trying different plants, new kinds of plants, new varieties of plants to see if one's going to do better than the other. And then in subsequent years, in the following years, I'm going to grow the ones that did better, right? And so I'm glad that they are doing this research here to basically, you know, provide them more food, but also provide the documentation on which varieties may produce more in certain geographical regions. And I do hope that they start to share some of the information and the knowledge and the experiments they've done over time to help other people in similar climates. Anyways, here they have about 20 different raised beds. They're all basically made out of like a roofing panel siding things. And you can see, you know, they do alternative technology. So like if you're in a developing country, you don't have a hose spigot with a hose that you can actually water the garden with. You don't have water pressure, right? So they got to come up with solutions to water. Maybe you're at your community garden, they don't give you water. Maybe you have a backyard and you're on watering restrictions, so you can't use the hose water. What do you do? Well, you basically could catch the water. You could basically build a concrete block stand out of concrete cinder blocks. You could put a 55 gallon drum on top and you could catch your rainwater in the drum. So what I would do is I'd make a big funnel up on the top, and they have these water collector funnels I seen some guy came up with, but you could make your own out of plastic or whatever. Make a big funnel so when it rains, that bucket fills up. Maybe you could have this next to a roof and have all the water running off the roof into the bucket, store it up, and then they have basically a simple tap on the bucket on the bottom. And they could turn that on, and then it basically goes directly into the irrigation system, the tubing, to you know, water all the plants from basically gravity-fed water. Now, if you don't have the plastic piping, that's all right. You could take out bamboo. You could take bamboo, slice it in half, and make like little waterway, like trough things, and have like little spouts to like water the garden. Now, that'd be really cool. So, I mean, there's so many different ways, and you know, this is the thing you're going to kind of learn here. This is what you're going to learn in my video, to like learn how they do things like in worlds where they might not have some of the modern conveniences that like we have come to expect, unfortunately, right? And anyways, they first have a couple of these gardens which are student gardens. So if you're a student here, you're going to get one of your own little gardens. Actually, it's quite big actually to manage, take care of. Luckily enough for you, they do have the plant starts that you get to choose from, and then you get to choose what you plant in your garden and the spacing that you want to do and all this stuff. Of course, they'll teach you guys how to do all this stuff. You'll then get to mulch it. So some of these are student gardens, and then the rest are basically production gardens to show living examples, real world examples of producing the food on the site for people that are visiting. So also they could get adjusted to, you know, changing, making dietary changes You know, when they go to different countries that are eating more of their staple crops, like the tubers, like that's why they have lots of sweet potatoes here that they'll be eating here just upcoming, because they're harvesting them now and they're putting in leeks right now and mulching them. Actually, I want to share with you guys a really novel leek planting technique that I learned here today. All right, so you might see Josh in the background, barely, because he's kind of mulching off right now, covering the top with leaves. A very important technique and tip I want to give you guys. You know, you guys always want to cover your soil. Before you put this mulch layer on, you put some, you know, rabbit poop and some compost down to basically enrich the soil, to bring further fertility onto the soil, to provide the leeks that they're growing here good nutrition. Now, to grow these guys, I learned a few tips here. Number one, to dig a hole for the little leek transplants they're dropping in. Wow, this guy's pretty heavy, man. This is like a big, look at this, that's like a big nail. I don't even know where you'd find one of these nails. But basically, they just take the nail and they shove it down. And then you can kind of rotate around if you need a bigger hole, and then you pull it up. Wow, man, this is a workout here. It's almost like lifting weights. And then what you're gonna do is, I don't have a fresh leek to show you guys, but we'll just pull this weed up. So say this is your leek right here, this thing. This is the roots. Pretend this is the roots here on the bottom, right? What you're gonna do, and then the leek comes up to here, you're gonna basically take the leek and actually bury it even a little bit deeper, much like you would bury a tomato stem a little bit deeper, because the tomato stem will root, right? You bury the leek stem a little bit and then basically cover it in. And then it's gonna grow a bigger edible flesh portion of leek to eat, right? So that's cool. So that's something I never knew. And then also, you know, they're topping that off with that topping. So, I mean, just simple tips like this I've learned along my journey coming to different farms, and now you know it too, without even having to come here. All right, we haven't even got out of the raised bed garden area yet, and just behind the raised bed garden area, they have fruit trees planted and other useful trees. If you guys live in Central Florida like they are here, these are two trees you will definitely want to grow. One's a fruit tree and one's a vegetable tree, or maybe even a tree of life, literally. These are super important, super critical that you grow these. Number one, they have papayas. They have lots of papayas growing. They have so many papayas that probably every morning for breakfast they eat fresh papayas. The people that come here, they're giving out papayas. They have so many papayas, they can't even eat them all. If they have bad papayas, they basically go to the chickens or the pigs, and so actually they eat pretty good. So papayas are one of the staple fruits they have. They have a few other staple fruits that they like a lot that you guys will learn about in this episode. But in addition, behind here, they have a moringa tree. This moringa tree has the largest circumference, that's how like big around it is, circle, of the trunk that I've like ever seen in my life. Like, I've been to Hawaii, I've been to places, but this has the biggest trunk. Now, part of the reason for that is sometimes in the cold weather it might die back, and they cut it back so that the trunk kind of gets a little bit bigger, and then it sends up the upshoots that can be a little bit thinner. But the moringa is basically a landscape tree for you here, where it doesn't freeze. If it doesn't freeze, it could take a small frost and the root will stay alive and the trunk might stay alive, and then it'll reshoot every year. Even in Las Vegas, I mean, it'll keep this guy alive against a south-facing wall, where I trim it back to a stump and then just cover it with mulch or cover it with a burlap. And you guys can get these leaves. They have multi kinds of moringa growing here. They also sell the moringa starts here, some healthy special variety starts. And these guys are good for the leafy greens they provide. I really want to encourage you guys to eat more greens and displace other foods you guys would eat. I mean, the greens these are like the best foods for losing weight. Why? Because a pound of leafy greens is maybe not even 100 calories, right? One tablespoon, just think, one tablespoon of oil, any kind of oil. I don't care if that's coconut oil, olive oil, flax oil. It's all like 120 calories per tablespoon. Or you could eat 1 pound of greens. Which one has more nutrition in it, the greens or the oil? Yes, you're right. The greens has way more nutrition than the oil. The oil has a lot more fat. And although even though the greens will also have some fat, but much smaller amounts. But also the greens have more of these phytochemicals, phytonutrients, vitamins, minerals that are essential for health. I think a big problem today, especially in America where we're eating processed foods, is you're not eating enough nutrient-dense foods, and greens are the basically poster child for nutrient-dense foods. And we're going to eat this on the camera right here for you guys right now. A lot of the foods you may be able to eat raw. Some of them will need heat processing, but I like to eat many of my foods raw because then you contain more nutrition. Some foods need to be cooked to kill off some of the bad anti-nutrients in there, but once again, if you heat any food, you may be degrading some nutrients, degrading bad nutrients, wanting to be a good thing, but you're also losing enzymes, you're losing antioxidants, and you're losing some of the things. So I'd encourage you guys, if applicable and safe to do so, to eat some raw foods. I feel perfectly safe in our first world country eating the moringa greens, as well as pretty much any other greens here at the farm, that they're basically not spraying any pesticides or chemicals on and growing all in natural methods. So they got a couple cool things going on here that I've never seen before. Number one is they got armadillo holes. I don't think I've seen armadillo holes. That's where like the armadillos go. Literally they're nesting underneath the raised beds. I don't think they dig up soil and look for like little millipedes or worms or something that could kind of do a lot of damage. But the other thing, in between their plants, which are like, this is their raised bed, they got different kinds of squash and maybe some okra and eggplant things growing. They got little cans. Why do you got the cans sitting in there, man? They look a little bit off. Well, these are traps, and actually it's catching some ants in there. There's some ants just crawling out. These are actually fire ants. And, you know, I was not aware, because I don't have fire ants on my side of the country where I live, but the fire ants can be very destructive to certain crops. So brassica family plants, even eggplants, they could basically bark the eggplant, which means they're going to chew off the little, you know, outer layer of the bark on the eggplant and then let the eggplant drip its sap or its juice, its sweet nectar, and suck it out, and thereby it will kill the eggplant. So they've been really battling the fire ants, and the most effective strategy they found is by basically putting out little, you know, reused cans. So repurposing instead of recycling is always the best, right? Even when you send something to get recycled, does it really get recycled, or does it get incinerated somewhere? I just never know. It's always best to actually not even use items or buy foods in cans, but to grow your own food so you don't have any cans to deal with in the first place, right? Anyways, or buy in bulk and bring your own containers, right? Anyways, the cans, what they do is they basically put in a solution of like boric acid and sugar, maybe a little bit of water in there, right? And that's a known ant bait, right? But if you want it to even be more effective, right, you need more than just the sugar and the boric acid. The ants might be able to smell the boric acid through the sugar, but if you add some peanut butter in there, for example, now they got a fat, they got a nice something aroma, like roasted peanut butter. Who cannot resist a roasted peanut butter? Definitely the ants are gonna love it. They're gonna suck it up with the boric acid and the sugar, and they're gonna take it back to their nest, and basically it's gonna take out the colony, right? Because I think the boric acid like explodes like a vinegar, baking soda solution exploded when you were a kid, like in a volcano, right, or something like that. Now, also, what they've learned that to use is they use actually bacon fat or bacon grease, like that fragrant bacon grease that, you know, if they're frying up, you know, some of the pigs they grew here to, you know, fry, to make bacon in the morning for the people here, they'll take some of the grease instead of the peanut butter, and that they found that also to be very effective. And I think that'd probably on some level smell good, but if you're vegan, it'd probably smell really bad. So the gardener here is a man of my own heart. You know, in my raised bed garden, basically I always have areas under production. Generally, I don't pull a section that is being productive until actually I pull it, and within the same day or sometimes the next day, I actually replant. So he makes the most use and most effective use of his raised bed gardening space, which I appreciate a lot. I mean, it's almost 7 o'clock here and he's out working hard when basically everybody else, the staff and the students, are in the kitchen eating dinner. Actually, he's over there watering still to make sure his plants are well planted and taken care of. So I really value him for that. So hey, he deserves a raise if you guys are the owners and watching this thing. So anyways, over here he's growing the taro root, which is now, you know, at its end of the season, and he's been pulling it out. That's actually what you saw. He pulled out a section earlier and gave it to the kitchen for them to prepare. And in addition, over here it looks like he's planting leafy greens in rows, and his goal is to basically plant things in rows and have it so tight so that when it grows up, it just totally fills in. Like some of his sweet potato beds are just totally packed with leaves. It almost looks overgrown on some levels because you can't even walk through the pathways in between because you're just overgrown with sweet potato vine. But that's good because those sweet potato vines are sending energy back in to the tubers to produce more tubers that they will get to enjoy here on the site. One of these days, I hope to really duplicate what they're doing here on a smaller scale, just for me and my family that I have not yet created yet. I need to find a girlfriend or a wife first to help me with that part of it. But anyways, they start all their own seeds here, you know, from seeds and or get cuttings and or other plants. They do a lot of different, you know, buying of rare and, you know, different genetics. He sources genetics from his trading partners literally all over the country, that he gets some super rare stuff that I never even knew about or learned. He'll go source plant materials at even local flea markets, and he's found all kinds of things at different places, which just amazes me that he finds so much, and that this is where they basically start the plants that then get planted out into their vegetable garden beds or the raised beds. So I mean, this place takes a lot of work, and I'm glad that he has students and maybe even sometimes interns and also volunteers. If you guys want to learn by hands-on experience, you guys can come here and volunteer for the day. Now, they're going to have you do certain jobs. You're probably not going to be doing some jobs, but there's plenty of jobs for volunteers where you can literally get your hands in the dirt and learn how to do some of this stuff firsthand. Hey, it's great to watch one of my videos to learn this stuff. I'll explain to you guys a lot, but there is no substitute for getting your hands in the dirt. So yeah, if you live in the area, definitely by all means, you know, contact the organization and see if you could come to volunteer in the garden. Trust me, you guys are going to learn a lot. They're a great bunch of people, and you might even walk away with some plant starts they'll give you at the end of the day. So if you thought you were on a budget because your wife keeps the finances, and or maybe your husband keeps the finances, they give you a certain amount of money to spend on your gardening every month, right? They're definitely on a budget here, and they're definitely underfunded in my opinion, right? They're having to scrape, scrounge, and just make things work. So this basically, this greenhouse behind me, was basically put together for like around $200. A lot of the pieces and components were things they had laying around. It's actually stemmed around a carport, and they're just basically using the arches of the carport that basically was demolished. And then they basically had a pole that they basically made taller, and they had to buy the mosquito netting to put around it. I think that was like $120. And then they had some on $60 of other materials, including the wire that had to buy, and then also they had like an old screen door that they used as the door. So the gardener here is very resourceful. But also, you know, if you guys are looking to make a donation, they need a sugarcane juicer. If you have a sugarcane juicer, donate a sugarcane juicer or donate some money to this nonprofit so that they continue their amazing work that they're doing. Anyways, inside here, they're growing the tomatoes, and they're doing mostly a single stem variety and holding it from up top, and then they're basically lowering the roof to let the bottom kind of trail on the ground so that it's easy to harvest. And meanwhile, all the top portion that doesn't have the ripe fruits continue to green leaf out, and they're single stemming. So they also have the cucumbers and tomatoes, and they might not even be able to do the cucumbers outside if they didn't have it in the structure, because this structure will control, number one, the insects from getting in because it has the screen on it, and number two, more importantly, the humidity or the rain. It'll control the wet water going in there, and also inside there is not going to get that dew that can bring fungus and disease with it that may get your plants and allow them to suffer and not get good production. So I really like that they're doing this, and you know, they continue to experiment to find new and different and innovative and inexpensive ways to grow more food. All right, so right behind me's got to be two of my favorite trees of the whole property. Number one, they got a peanut butter fruit tree. I had a peanut butter fruit earlier. I think I had one only maybe once or twice before in my life, and I really wasn't impressed, but I will say that I was impressed with the peanut butter fruit that I had here. It really actually tasted like peanut butter to me. It was actually also fairly perfectly ripe and deep red. Another tree that I like that I've never seen before in my life that's currently in flower, so I'm not going to get to try the amazing fruit, is a tropical jujube. So I had an episode on the jujube fruit. A guy in Vegas basically has 60 varieties of jujubes in his backyard. I'll post a link down below to that video in the description. If you guys haven't seen that, I encourage you guys to check that out. But there's a tropical jujube. And actually, this is grown, I think, primarily like over in India. And I forget the Indian name of it that you'd have to search for, because you just can't search tropical jujube. You're not going to find that. You got to find the Indian name for it and then do a search based on that. And it's currently in flower. And that does excellent here in the tropics, right? Standard jujubes won't necessarily do well, except that they've done trials with standard varieties of jujubes to find out which one works the best in this climate zone. And actually, I'll take you guys over there and show you guys what variety they found worked the best in case you guys want to grow a standard jujube here in Florida or other areas in a similar climate. All right, so this might not look like much right now, but this is a jujube basically kind of going dormant because it's the end of the season here for the standard jujube, and he tried several different varieties, including the GA something and the sugarcane variety. None of those didn't produce too well, but this variety is called the Tiger Tooth, and this is his best producer. He's actually going to keep it. The other two he's probably going to cut out, and it's available from I think Fruits and Exotics or something in Tallahassee, maybe, I don't know. But yeah, this is the best variety for maybe the tropical era with low chill hours, so that's the one you guys want to try. That's been the one he's been most successful with, also with his poor soil conditions. I'm here outside the pig pen. Literally, this is the pig pen where they have actually the mama pig and probably lots of baby pigs. Whatever you do, don't stick your hands in the pig pen. The pigs can bite. Another cool thing they do is actually they feed the pigs all the scraps from the kitchen, but more importantly, they also have local schools donate basically all the food-based waste that then feeds the pigs. So I kind of like the model of reusing food instead of having to buy like fresh feed for animals. I will give a comment that I do not believe that this is a good area to keep the pigs. I believe it's to be too small, but that's just my personal opinion. But you know, they got to do what they got to do here to share. So you know, if they get donated food like the Cheetos here, that does not get eaten by the people that come through, then they will basically feed the junk food to the pigs. I do not advocate this either, but I'll be feeding this junk food to the pigs and I'll see if they eat it. And yes, they're gobbling up the junk food. I do not recommend you guys to feed any animals junk food. It's not good for us. And in my opinion, it's not good for the animals either. All right, this is a village nursery where they basically have the different plant starts available for you guys right now. It's October, so it's kind of like their slow time of year, so they're not really replenishing until it gets to be March. But they have like really nice moringa varieties here. Lots of the different fruit trees, including like fig trees. I think they're like $10. Lots of affordable prices for things like the katuk, also the longevity spinach, or Gynera procumbens, maybe the Okinawan spinach, and many of the other different perennial greens that you'll see, the edible basket vine crop, another one that I really like a lot. I really want you guys to focus on growing some greens around you in your space. Learn about all the different greens that can grow here, basically unattended, even through the hot summers that you guys get. A lot of these more Asian vegetables will do wonderful here, and you'll literally have hedges of greens that you could eat pretty much throughout the year, unless it gets too cold. So there are so many different, kinds of gardening here on site, and many different examples. I'll not get to show you guys all of them because it is getting dark now. So I'm gonna try to pick out some of the most valuable things that I learned on this trip with you guys. But one of the things I want you guys to do is like have one of these arches. This is basically like a hog panel. That's what it's called, hog panel fencing. Or you can get utility fencing, and they're basically growing the muscadine grapes up it. If you guys live here in the South, I would encourage you guys strongly to grow the muscadine grapes, because they're not like a harvest the whole, bunch and eat them kind of thing. They basically ripen, they spot ripen. So you're going to go out there and harvest a couple, eat them, harvest a few more the next day when they're ripen and eat them. And that's a good thing for the home gardener. For maybe commercial production, it's bad because it requires a lot of labor, but for you guys, it's going to be good. And the native peoples and the muscadine grapes were really native here to the Americas before the white man came. And there are actually some really good varieties of muscadines that I've researched. They grow lots of varieties here in the back. I won't be able to get to show you guys. I did have some ones that were quite tasty. And me personally, being from the West, where I've eaten grapes out my yin yang, and especially most table grapes, in my opinion, they suck. They do not taste good. They're not what a grape should be. They should be selling wine grapes, in my opinion, instead of making wine out of them. We should be able to eat them fresh because they have amazing flavor, amazing taste. The muscadine grapes are what table grapes should be like. And they're amazing and easy to grow and pest resistant because they were here before chemicals and pesticides and synthetic fertilizer were even invented. Yeah, and then grow them up a nice trellis like this to basically have an archway or a breezeway of edible muscadines in the season. So what you guys are looking at behind me here is literally, this is one of my dreams. And I want you guys to take this seriously. If you guys live in the Orlando area, in this general area, region, vicinity, Tampa, St. Pete, Pinellas Park, I don't know, anywhere's around here, the lake area, this is what you guys should have. I want all you guys' front yards, or at least a portion of your yard or your backyard or somewhere, to have something like this. Look at this. Green as far as I can see. Now there is a little entryway like right over here because they're demonstrating like a little school kids garden or a kids garden like off in a third world country, where basically you have a hedge of edible vegetable plants, and then inside the garden they have basically the more annual crops, annual vegetables. But this way, if the school garden had basically a green hedge surrounding the vegetable garden to protect it, right, all these greens right here, you guys don't understand, this is all food for some animals, but also for humans. You could come to the plant, like right here, and take your hand and just pull it back and strip it out, right? And strip all the leaves open, they fell. So let's get a couple more here. Come and strip them all back, and I basically could harvest leaves in an instant, right? There are thousands of freaking branches I could harvest here, have all these leaves to eat, and these are my favorite leaves in the whole world to eat. This is called katuk, or soropus. And they also have a variegated variety here that does not grow as well, or maybe is as tasty, so they really advocate growing the green variety. And this could be a stable food source for you guys year-round. And I mean, I want to have this much katuk, so like at any day of the year, I could literally eat this, provided it's not too cold. If it gets too cold, like in the tropics, it would look like this. You know, if they get too cold of a spell, they might lose some of this, it might die back, but then it's going to come back, you know, once the temperatures warm up. But I mean, this is an amazing food source, and why don't more people know about katuk? It's because people are fixated on growing annual vegetables. I want my lettuce, John. No, I want all you guys to say, I want my katuk, and come here, buy some katuk plants. And literally, these guys are so easy to start. You literally could just break off a stem, put it in the ground, and these are all propagated by cuttings. In addition, what you guys could do is you guys could come to the top tip of the plant, right? Like this. You could come to the top tip of the plant and break it off. And if we break this off like this, I mean, this is all edible too, but I want to show you guys what this looks like. What does that look like if you look at it? It looks like a little baby asparagus. You could eat this as asparagus, as a substitute, tropical asparagus. Just near the tip, if it gets too far down, like this is getting too far down, it gets kind of foot fibrous and woody. But this is a delicious, amazing food crop that more countries around the world in the tropics and certain subtropics should grow and use. Now, I want to let you guys know that they are in a zone 9A here. That being said, I'm also in a zone 9A. So should I, because I'm in the same zone as them, 9A, should I be able to grow everything like they're growing here? Totally no way, man. We're in different zone 9As. The zone designation says how cold it gets, not how the climate is, right? In my zone 9A, it is dry as heck. In this zone 9A, it's humid as heck, right? Also, in the nights, in the winter times, although it may get down to 25, the day still might be 70 degrees. It might be nice and warm in the days. In my zone 9A, it could be like 26 at night, and then in the days, it might only get up into 40s or 50s. So totally different zone 9A. So, you know, if you live in Florida zone 9A, you might be able to get away with a lot of the things they're growing here. All right, so I want to hand cam some of this because it's gonna be a little bit quicker than taking you guys. So this is basically the katuk hedge that you guys see, just as you guys can see all the way around. We could go in and then we could see cassava, and optimally they would have a vegetable garden planted in there. We're not gonna go in there today because it's getting dark really fast, but I want to show you guys this. This is the urban garden. So this concrete pad literally simulates a roof. Now this area definitely is under construction. You know, they basically don't grow this in the summertime because it is too hot. They grow mostly annuals in here. My suggestion was to grow some perennials in here, so at least half the beds would always look pretty good. They got things like basil in here, and they're growing basically literally on a concrete roof by putting in some you know, bricks and basically filling it with soil. So like literally on a roof you guys could grow. And then even they're using like half buckets over there. They're even growing in things like tires that have been hollowed out and planting in tires. Over here they basically have one of those big freestanding file cabinet, you know, cupboards, you know, and they're just growing in there. They got basically, this is made out of roofing material. This is kind of neat. They've actually just bent the corners, so there's no edges on it except one where they're adjoined. They're growing in bathtubs. I mean, they're growing in the 55-gallon drums cut the lengthways. They're growing in like those cheap totes that you can get at Walmart. I will caution you against growing in those because they are not UV treated and they will break down. Something even more durable than one of those is like get an old cooler, right? Buy a cooler at the flea market, right? You got to drill some holes in the bottom for drainage, and you guys could grow in that too. I mean, there's so many. Oh, and look, they're even growing in a washing machine, right? That's totally crazy. They got basil and culantro growing in there. Of course, in an urban garden, they also have things like the chickens that they do harvest the eggs from regularly. And they have lots of different containers over here that you can grow food in. I mean, you can grow containers in little pots, in 5-gallon buckets. There's so many different ways to grow food, so let your imagination drive your creativeness. All right, moving on the tour, they basically have a hill garden. So this is the hill country. Well, not exactly, because this is all flatland here. But basically they took a tractor and they basically built up this hill to show, because most of the world that are in poor populations might have undesirable land like hills. So they basically have created, using like scrap concrete, riprap or whatever, concrete, to basically build like terraces so that they could grow in and trellis things up. They built, actually, if you guys could look beyond the weeds, because they do need a lot of weeding and they need a lot of labor here, and they've been short lately. on, they have tires that are basically used as steps. They've also grown different kinds of plants here as like, you know, hedgerows to basically hold the soil from the roots of the plants will hold the soil so it will not erode down the hill. Of course, they got the cassava, which is a staple food, you know, across the world, and I think they should probably eat a lot more of it. They're going to be harvesting it really soon, and they get to eat a lot more of it pretty much year round. In addition, going over here, they got basically nopalis cactus. You could eat the cactus pads. I did show that in my last episode. And they have so many different things, including, you know, butterflies. You know, aside from planting edible food crops, they have many different pollinator crops, beneficial insect attractant crops, native crops. They have just basically the whole gamut of different kinds of crops.
Let's talk about fig trees. I love figs, and coming from California, where I've been to like Sonoma, California, where I've literally walked underneath a canopy, like a big canopy of a 100-year-old fig tree, literally, that was 100 years old. That was just super productive, amazing figs in the nice dry climate. And it did amazing here in the South. You know, they have challenges growing figs. And here's a fig tree here, and this thing looks pretty abysmal to me, in my opinion, coming from the West, where we actually have really good figs because we more duplicate that, you know, Mediterranean climate that the figs like. The big problem with the figs here is the nematodes that mess up the fig roots, so the plants can't be that healthy for that long. But they've found a solution to do that here by basically grafting on the fig, you know, top growth to a rootstock of a ficus, a tropical ficus, or maybe even a cold hardy ficus. That will do good here, that is nematode resistant. So I'm going to take you guys inside the greenhouse right behind and share with you guys how they're doing it. So this is their research greenhouse that they need to put some probably new plastic up before it gets too cold. They got some tropical fruit trees that they could grow year-round in here, such as like a mango and some other things. And but I want to share with you guys actually some of the experiments they're doing and some of the cool things I learned about here. Some of these things are one of a kind that I'd never even seen before in my life. And this goes to show you guys the extent that the gardener will go through to get some of these rare genetics to basically make some of these available to people in the area by through the nursery once they have these established and that they know they're going to grow well. He searches far and wide, even harder than I do, to get some of these rare species, and I wonder literally where he has the time to do all the work that he does. I mean, he's one totally amazing guy. So Josh showed me probably like 1/100th of what he has going on here. All I know is that this guy is a relative of New Zealand spinach, which is a perennial leafy green. That's what he told me, and it's a purple leaf variety of a New Zealand spinach, so he's trying to get that to go. He just got cuttings off that one from a guy in Orlando. Probably Josh's most prized plant are these guys right here. Oh, I blew on him. Don't mess him up, man. So this is actually a black sapote relative from Baja, California that is supposed to be cold tolerant. So he's really excited about these guys and to raise them up to see if they actually work or not. And then if they do, he will be making them available. Also, he's growing like the natal plum and basically grow them through a pot to basically root them in the pot because this branch is actually still connected because there's a hole in the pot that's coming out of this other plant over there. Anyways, we're going to flip you guys around and show you guys the work he's doing with the ficus and the fig. All right, so this is a ficus and a fig. So, you know, like John, you're saying, that looks like a fig. Well, yes, up top, it's a fig. But if we look down here, this whole bottom section is a ficus. The fig is you know, in the same kind of family as the ficus. So basically, if properly done, you could basically graft on the fig to the ficus. I think he did maybe a cleft graft here to get this to accept onto the bottom. And it, as you guys can see, it's growing perfectly now. And now the ficus root system is nematode resistant, so now he's gonna get hopefully better production with the figs. And so this is amazing. Now, in addition to the standard grafting techniques, he taught me a new grafting technique that I was not even aware of called the approach grafting technique. And I wanna share with you guys next. All right, so now I wanna share with you guys the approach grafting technique. So normally in grafting, you basically use a kind of a cut stem of the donor plant to go on a rootstock or the other plant you're getting. In the approach grafting technique, you actually need two live plants. So he has basically one in a pot right here that I'm shaking. So it's like this guy right here. And then he has another pot like right here next door that actually is still attached. And what he's done is basically he's kind of like attached still living, you know, this plant to this plant. So he's kind of skinned it back to basically join them and mate them. He's used that grafting tape. I think maybe he does some kind of like cleft graft to make this fit in.
And then slowly he'll basically cut this back slowly over time, you know, or cut the one back that he wants to, you know, keep and basically finally cut it off from the mother plant. So then he'll basically, this is like an easier, more gentler approach to grafting, because sometimes species will not be directly compatible. But if you do this approach style grafting, you know, there'll be maybe more cases that you'll be able to do grafting with similar related plants. I don't know exactly what two these are, but you know, I thought that was neat to learn because I've never seen that done before any place I visited. Another really cool thing they're doing is they're growing fish here. They're also growing duckweed, which I didn't get to show you guys, in basically IBC totes. Some of the water from the fish ponds actually filter into this experimental greenhouse to do more experiments. So this is the water down below, basically is the fish water. So it has like the fish poop in there. And basically they have these big, I don't know, 15 gallon or so pots sitting in the water, but not all the way down in the water, maybe only like an inch down. So the bottom is always submerged and they have some good potting soil in there. And they're growing fruit trees. And some of these fruit trees actually live on riverbanks. So they're trying to simulate how these plants would grow in nature. Meanwhile, we dig up some of these plants, we try to grow these in the middle of the orchard, and we wonder why they don't work, because that's not their native habitat. Sometimes plants are adaptable and can adapt to the situations we put them in. Sometimes they don't, and so you will want to try to duplicate how that plant would have been grown normally. So this one is actually kind of a dragon fruit cross with a yellow dragon fruit, with a standard variety dragon fruit, so I'm looking forward to the fruit quality on those guys. He has some kind of like a rare sop plant. I forget what kind of, like, it's like a small sop. I don't know, I forget what the name is. He has a miracle fruit, actually, that actually two down there wasn't doing so good. And this guy has done amazingly in this system. So I don't know all the different plants he has in there. But yeah, I mean, so I want you guys to think about different ways of growing things, right? And when I have my own place, I want to duplicate some of the systems he's doing here. Maybe not in the exact same way, but you know, the more ways and more ecosystems or more microclimates, the more different ways you grow food or can produce to grow food, guess what? The range of food and production you can have can be wider. Maybe in certain countries when, you know, some of the students that end up graduating from here, come out of the program here, they go to a place where there's a riverbank, they're like, hey, I remember Josh taught me that I could grow the miracle berry, you know, right in standing water, so that'd be a perfect one to plant on the riverbank, so now I can provide food for people. But if you try to plant other plants in this situation, it's not gonna work. So, you know, I really love that this is like real world examples of what it could be like in countries literally around the world that you could even duplicate in your yard if you want to. All right, I think I have two more shots before I'm gonna go ahead and interview Josh for you guys, because it's getting kind of dark here. This part was a very important part that I want to share with you guys. You guys can't probably see it too good, and I'm not gonna do a walkthrough, but basically you gotta trust me on this. If you guys came here, you'd see all these amazing tropical fruit trees behind me that he has living here in his zone 9A. Yes, it can freeze here in the wintertime, get like mid 20s or high 20s, right? And most tropical fruit trees will just totally lose their life. He's got star fruit, he's got different kind of like anonas trees, he's got, you know, trees that will basically just freeze out. Once it gets below 32, they're done for, right? He's using a very novel technique, using just water to protect his plants. What he does, and I don't know if you guys can see that, but he has sprinklers sitting up really high, and he'll basically just sprinkle water over all the plants before he has a freeze. Then guess what? What happens? The water sits on the plants and the water freezes. You're like, John, that's bad. You're freezing water on your plants. But here's the thing. Frost is also an insulator. So here, imagine this. You know, this is the leaf. The water lands on the leaf. The water freezes, right? The water is frozen at 32 degrees, right? It's basically encapsulating the leaf, the water. So now the water is actually acting as insulation. So now the water freezes at 32, right? The water is frozen at 32. That means all the tissues in the plant is basically stuck in time at 32 degrees. Meanwhile, just over here, the air temperature is now at 24 because it's even gotten colder, right? But meanwhile, the ice is still at 32, the plant's at 32 because it acts as insulation. So this keeps the plant alive. Not gonna say it's like gonna be thriving when it comes out of the frost the next day, it's 70 degrees, but he can confidently say that he's kept these plants alive, and that's one way to conquer you know, the freezing temperatures. You know, another way is to wrap up your plants and spend all this time to do that. But I think a real novel approach is to basically use your sprinklers. Also, he has these planted against some kind of structure here, so that may also help with shading the wind and creating a little bit of microclimate. Plus, he has a few overstory trees. and maybe also a windbreak as well to create a nice little microclimate area that he can protect during the winter to keep some of his more prized fruit trees alive that actually are not in, you know, an undercover hoop house or greenhouse. All right, this next technique is something I've never learned about or heard about until today, and I should have learned about this earlier. You know, this just made the starfruit tree one of my primary plants I will plant as soon as I get property in the tropics. I always thought papayas grow pretty quick and yield pretty fast. Bananas also produce pretty fast. And yeah, starfruit, you know, from a rooted cutting, a transplant, you could get fruit within a year. But then the challenge is some starfruit will produce now, some produce later, so have multiple varieties of starfruit so you can get a consistent, you know, fruit crop. But if you want to even get a higher fruit crop, you can induce flowering in starfruit, maybe by cutting off the water. So you want to basically put a tarp down so the plant cannot get water for a number of days, and then take off the tarp and then flood water. That might induce flowering, which then will cause fruiting to occur. Or if you want to do it micro flowering, you could actually control the flowering from literally each stem of the plant. So I'm going to demonstrate for you guys. So basically we're taking a stem of the plant or a branch that does not have any flowers on it. And number first step is we're going to strip the branch. I'm going to come here. I'm going to break off all the greenery, right? So now we just have literally a stick there, right? Next step is we break off the tip, drop that down on the ground, let it mulch in place. And now what do we have? We have a stick here. Then what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead to the end, you know, where it joins the next section, and then we're going to bend up. And I want you guys to listen carefully. You want to bend up, not to break it, but just to cause a little kink in it, and then it's going to kind of snap, but it's not, you're not going to break it off, and you're not going to expose any of the inner bark, cambium layer, or anything like that. But I took it up until it broke, right? When you do that, what happens, right? Now this branch is stressed. It cannot get the auxins or the chemicals or whatever they get, the hormones, at the end of the stem, and this stem says, I'm in crisis mode. Something's going on. I need to flower and set fruit because I might be at the end of my life or something like that. I mean, this is kind of what I think it's happening. But anyways, once you do this, then guess what? You're going to see a whole line of flowers produce on this, like within 20 days and then shortly thereafter. Guess what? You're going to have fruiting on this branch. So literally, you can't induce fruiting. What if you can induce a child in a girl like that? That'd be kind of fun. But yeah, so you can induce fruiting on your crop, and you can have star fruits any time of year, even if you just have one tree. That being said, I would encourage you guys to grow different varieties of trees because there's so many different kinds of star fruit. There's sweet ones, there's sour ones, there's flying tongue ones, there's wang chung, there's yang, no, just kidding. there's all different kinds of star fruits. Anyways, it's getting far too dark to be filming outside. We're gonna go ahead and find Josh and sit down with him, hopefully in a well-lit area, to show you guys more about the H.E.A.R.T. organization and farm here. All right, so now I have the pleasure of introducing to you guys Josh Jamison. He's the garden manager here at H.E.A.R.T. Village, which is a nonprofit organization that I got to share with you guys a little bit about. As you guys can see, it's like super pitch black outside now, and I wish I got to show you guys more. There's so much more I should have went over, but we just hung out, had a good time pretty much for most of the day, and then I filmed just a little bit at the end. But we're going to get him on camera to share some of his knowledge with you. I love this guy. He's like a brother from another mother. He's so knowledgeable, literally, because what? This is his life. I mean, he lives, breathes, eats the food that he grows. I mean, from sun up to sundown, literally, I had to grab him out of the fields. He was still working, and we had to come in here. I'm like, man, I got to interview before I leave. He was still working out there, and you know, that is the dedication that it takes to, you know, gain knowledge and even get better at what you do on a daily basis. And literally, I think you've been here, like 8 years now, day to day, just in and out, growing foods, experimenting, trying things, knowing what works, knowing what doesn't. I mean, to literally be an expert for growing in this area, in this particular climate zone, from what I've seen. And he continues to learn and research and even go and find old books from like Mennonite farmers that were growing like sugarcane sorghum. To like learn from even old school, he learns from the internet, he learns from books, he learns from different people, he learns from all over the place. So I really commend you. He probably does more learning than I do, and he's out in the garden too. So wow, this guy is totally amazing. So Josh, I have a few questions for you. So first, why don't you tell my viewers more about H.E.A.R.T.? I couldn't explain it other than what was in the brochure because I don't live or work here, and you've been here for so long.
Yeah. So H.E.A.R.T. is a simulated developing world village. And it's a training center for students who want to go do service work around the world, whether as missionaries or in doing things like the Peace Corps or all kinds of development work amongst the poor in the developing world.
Cool. And then how is this whole place funded, right?
It's funded through donations and through students' tuitions. And also we do some sales of plants and some things like that as well.
Yeah, cool. So if you really like the organization, like what they're doing here, hey, I'll put a link down below to their website. You could make a donation or maybe even come here as a, you know, through the program or as like a day student to learn or even as a volunteer to help out and literally get your hands in the dirt. So Josh, what has been your biggest challenge here growing and running the program as the garden manager?
So the biggest challenge here in terms of gardening is probably the soil. This is some of the worst soil probably in the world. It's like a big sand dune basically, which is a downside, but it's also a pro because we're trying to develop techniques that can work in other difficult climates. So in one way, it's kind of instructive about learning about trying to grow in adverse conditions like soil. Also, the climate can be a little bit challenging because we basically have the tropics for half of the year. So all the challenges that come with the tropics, like the sweltering heat and humidity and the pest pressure that comes with that. But then we also get these nights with freezing temperatures. So a lot of the tropical things are teetering on the edge of being right at home. But those 5 nights a year where it gets below 32 can knock things back. So it's been kind of a challenge to try to find things that work here. But despite all that, there's plenty of things that we're able to grow and do really well with.
Cool. So how have you been building the soil to be able to grow some of these amazing fruits and have the amazing, you know, raised bed vegetable garden that you do?
So the key to healthy crops in all climates, but especially in the tropics and subtropics, is organic matter. If you look at the way that the tropical soils work is that fertility doesn't really build up in deep topsoil like you have in the colder climates, like in Nebraska where you have 8 feet of topsoil or whatever. It's a constant exchange that's going on as plants grow and biomass falls, and it's immediately picked up by another living organism. So in the tropics or subtropics, when you remove the forest, that's when soil really rapidly goes into decay, much faster than it does in the cold climate. So in order to reverse that, the key is just anything that leads towards more organic matter in the soil. So mulches, cover crops, compost, manure, anything like that, and just really, really big doses of organic matter every season, to no matter what kind of crop it is, and always keeping the soil covered with mulch.
Cool. And so what have been some of the crops you're growing that do the best in this climate without protection? Because I know, you know, some of you guys want to just have an easy garden where you literally plant, let's say, perennial vegetables. What are some perennial vegetables that do really well with little care? Because I know some might take a little bit more care.
Yeah, so the best perennial vegetables for us would be chia or tree spinach. That's a cooked green. Katuk is another.
You say katuk because you're from the south. Katuk.
Katuk or katuk.
I say katuk. You know, yeah.
Whichever. Papaya as a green. You know, you can cook the fruit green. We've got a cat making an appearance here. Papaya as a cooked or fresh green fruit. Of course, there's moringa.
How about the Okinawan spinach and the
Goji spinach are good ones. And then all the root crops, they're sort of tropical crops,
right.
Sort of perennials, but we do kind of grow them as annuals. All the tropical root crops, cassava, sweet potato, taro. There's really a whole slew of other ones that aren't coming to my mind right now.
Cool. And then how about some fruits that really do well without too much work or protection or having an overhead sprinkle them and keep them warm in the winter?
So loquat would be a number one choice.
Oh, really?
Loquat are very common in this area. They take the cold. Mulberries, also great. You can grow, again, papaya as a ripe fruit is really good. Getting into all sorts of other fruits like figs and pomegranates, some things that maybe do better in places like California, but they're special varieties that can be grown in Florida, like with figs. LSU Purple is a variety that does really well here. Jujubes, both tropical and the cold climate jujubes. The variety Tiger Tooth can grow without cold protection. Avocados, cold hardy avocados. So there's really a lot. Bananas are another good one.
So one of the questions I have for you, Josh, is, you know, I know you grow a lot of crops from literally around the world that you guys grow here in the middle of Florida. And I think a big challenge with some of the crops is that people in America and from here are not used to eating some of the crops. So you want to talk about, you know, this this challenge, although the crop grows easily and you can have a ton of it, like if you grow a ton of it but nobody eats it because they don't like it or they don't know how to prepare it properly, like in traditional ways or how it was traditionally eaten, like that could be a problem.
Right. So there are certain crops that have grown really well that we've had a hard time trying to find a way to cook. But my wife, Emily, has been really good at trying to learn about international cuisine and also do all sorts of experimentation. And there's other people in Florida that are doing similar work trying to figure out how to utilize all these things that are mostly from the tropics. And here we in the United States mostly have a culture that's been inherited from European cuisine and European vegetables. So we have this whole world of crops, you know, to learn about, things from the mostly from the tropics. So one great way is to just look to the cultures where those foods come from. So we're talking about Africa, Central America, Southeast Asia. And then also a lot of the things, if you view them as kind of a substitute for something that you're familiar with, then you can wean your way into using that item. And then as you become more comfortable with it as an ingredient, you can move more into viewing it as its own thing. For instance, yams, taro and cassava, you can kind of view as a potato substitute. And then as you become more familiar with them, you will be more comfortable with trying new recipes kind of as its own ingredient.
Cool. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of interesting, right? Like European style diets in the olden days were like based around annuals, right? And then like, you know, more tropical climates always were based around perennial food systems. And definitely one of these food systems are more sustainable, in my opinion, and probably proven by science, than the other. So Josh, which one of these food systems, whether it's annual food system, which is what most Americans and Europeans may be eating, is more sustainable, or perennial food systems, and why?
So I think that with the broad strokes, the perennial food systems are more sustainable, more resilient, to drought, to all sorts of other adverse conditions. But I think that for a really successful food system, we need to have both because, yeah. One, the annual crops offer a lot of cuisine things that we want. Like I want to eat cilantro and tomatoes and onions and those things. But also something that I've been thinking about is like when we had a hurricane come through, the hurricane knocks over all the perennial crops and nothing's available. But if I have a packet of turnip seeds, I can go out. There's no reason I can't go out the day after the hurricane and plant them and then have something to eat in 40 days.
Or even radishes in 15 or 20 right. or 25.
Exactly. So I think that the two can work really well together. There's plenty of systems out there that integrate the two.
Yeah.
And annuals don't need to be grown in exclusively in huge monocrop systems. They can be integrated into farms alongside of perennials, and that's probably the most sustainable approach.
Yeah, and that's actually one of the approaches he does here that I was not able to share with you guys because it got too dark too quick. And, you know, I want you guys to try to focus your diets around perennial crops as much as possible. I know if you don't live in the tropics and you're in Boston or New York City, it might be a little bit more difficult, but there are still perennial crops that you got to grow in your area that are basically going to come back year after year and grow great. A lot of fruit trees, right? I mean, the other thing about perennial crops and annual crops, generally they have to pull them up, they have to till. Well, you don't have to till, but you know, you're disturbing the soil more than with perennials that are basically growing in one place. They're just sending down deep roots, and they basically encourage more, you know, the perennial crops encourage more like soil microbiology and create healthier soils, right, without as much disturbance. And yes, I would definitely agree that, you know, I eat a combination of perennial and annual crops. So a lot of many fruit trees you might just plant once. I mean, you might call that an annual because their fruit's only once. I would call it a perennial because it's basically there once. And you just, you know, it keeps producing year after year without you pretty much doing anything except maybe some minor care. And grow the standard jujube. That's one of the most tolerant trees to grow. And if you live in many parts of the country, pawpaws. I have an episode on pawpaws, another amazing fruit that literally was just growing here wild before the white man came. There's so many cool crops that we are just not familiar with because it doesn't ship well. You want to talk about that on some of the perennial vegetables?
Sure.
That it's really hard to find some of these perennial vegetables because literally katuk, you pick it, I mean, within 3 minutes, it's wilted. I mean, you probably pick it, bring it over to the kitchen here, and it's probably wilted unless you stick it in a vase of water.
Yeah, a lot of the fruits as well. A lot of those things you're not going to find in a market because they may not ship well, or people just don't have the knowledge or the technology on how to harvest them and move them across the country. And also maybe just there's not as enough of a demand to, you know, to require, or, you know, to spur people to grow enough to ship. A lot of the really interesting fruits are actually very perishable and don't ship well. Things like American persimmons or mulberries or even loquats, things like that, you often don't see in the market. The best way to eat it is just right off of a tree, or bringing it in and making it into jams or fruit leather or whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, I mean, I would say the peanut butter fruit, I mean, I'd buy a case of that stuff. It was so good. I got one, and they're still ripening them up there. And yeah, and pawpaw is another fruit. Like, you'll probably never see that in the markets. They are so fragile. I mean, when I bought them from the farmer, she puts, like, the bubble wrap underneath to protect them so they don't get bruised, you know, on my way home. And I carried 20 pounds on the airplane in bubble wrap, and people were kind of looking at me funny, but that's a whole other topic. But Josh, another thing I know you do here a lot, which I appreciate a lot, and I want to encourage you guys out there to do it, is experiment. You constantly experiment and trying, you know, whatever, 21 varieties of different sweet potatoes to find the ones or the couple that are going to do really good for you, so then you could grow those in the future, so you're not basically wasting space, you're producing the most food, but also being able to share this valuable knowledge with some of the students that come through here, and maybe they can literally change the world by experimenting or trying some of the varieties that have done here. You know, across the world in a similar climate, when the country, some peoples of different areas might be growing the wrong variety, that could, it could yield double by simply changing the variety of what's being grown.
Yeah, experimentation is one of the most important things you can do to just stay fresh as a culture, as a gardener. Constantly be trying new things. I have plenty of examples of crops where the difference between one variety and the next is a huge harvest and getting virtually nothing based on disease resistance, just certain attributes about that particular variety that don't adapt well to this climate. So I'm always trying to bring in new genetics of things and trial things against each other, and it doesn't need to be all scientific. It can just be growing half a year row is this variety, half a year row is another variety, and you take notes at the end of the season and you repeat with the one that does well. So every season I feel like if I'm not staying fresh by planting new things, I'm dying. You gotta be always staying fresh and bringing in new things and trying new things. And even if you think you've got it dialed in perfect and you've got the best varieties, there's always something else out there that can be adding to your nutritional profile of your diet, adding to the diversity of your garden, or adding to the beauty of your garden. All these amazing genetics in the world, you know, only enhance our food system.
Absolutely, and that does not occur from GMOs, in my opinion. They're trying to breed in nutrients by GMOing food. That's not the way. And actually, I challenge you, Josh, to, on the camera, is to find a sweet variety that's actually a sweet potato variety that's purple, you know, that is really high yielding, because purple fruits and vegetables are even more nutritious than, you know, some of the white sweet potatoes and their white counterparts, because of the anthocyanins that have been proven to help with many different chronic health conditions in, you know, laboratory studies, you know, on animals, small animal rodents that I don't agree with. But anyways, Josh, what is the sweet potato variety that you found to do the best at present time? And once again, this is his current research, and, you know, he's only been doing this for 8 years. I mean, if you do it once, you prove something that, yeah, in that season with that particular climate, with all that, you've learned that this year this does well, but doesn't mean that next year there might be a little bit different climate, the sun's a little bit off, the heat days, it warms up sooner, cools sooner, you know, whatever. It might change, so always be open and don't, I found the best one this year, so I'm just going to grow this for the rest of my life. No, it doesn't work that way. Nature does not work that way.
Yeah, so the best sweet potato from my trial this season was called Tainong 64. And it's a Taiwanese cultivar, and pretty much anything vegetable or fruit-wise that comes out of Taiwan is going to be good, because they breed some of the best stuff in the world. And
also the climate is similar?
It's fairly similar to here. So a lot of the stuff out of Taiwan will do well here. It just seems to be kind of a baseline rule. And they also have very interesting advanced agricultural technology there. The second best one was called Tokasita. And that one came out of a breeding or selection program by Dr. Franklin Martin, who was an amazing USDA researcher who primarily worked with root crops. And then the third best one was a purple one.
Oh, cool!
Yeah, and I don't know the name of it, actually, because I wrote unknown purple on the label, so I don't... But what I didn't like about that one is it would have long strings and then the potatoes hiding far away. So I had to like tear the bed apart to get to the potatoes. Yeah. Where the tainan were all clustered right under the plant. And I got about 6 pounds per plant, and they're at a 1 foot spacing. So it's really, you get a really a lot per square foot on that variety.
Yeah, I guess it depends what's more important to labor or hunting and digging. I kind of like hunting and digging, and I would go for the purple ones myself. Yeah. But everybody's a little bit different, you know, and I think nutrient will if it's more nutritious, I don't care if I get a little bit less yield or harvest, as long as I get a good, decent yield. I mean, that's my main focus on growing, maybe not to maximize the actual production for if you're trying to feed all the people that come through here. I know you got a bit more pressures.
We're trying to do no-till as much as possible, too. So, you know, just tearing the garden apart was like running a tiller through it for the purple one.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Of course, I don't like to disturb the soil any more than absolutely necessary just to harvest my crops and, digging up sweet potatoes, which I'll be doing probably when I get back to Las Vegas. Before it gets too cold to dig up my potatoes, and I drew some purples and standards and maybe about 3 varieties this year. Cool. So I know another thing that's really important to Josh is about countries around the world and being able to share what you've learned and getting people fed literally around the world, because it's a huge problem in this day and age when we think we have grocery stores and we're good, but what about the rest of the world that is, you know, developing? That, I mean, they're going through literally feast or famine in many cases.
Yeah. So one of my main passion for being here is hoping to make some sort of impact on global poverty, global malnutrition. But for me, that work is also, I don't want to see it as I have something, I'm smart and I teach you, but it's a mutual exchange.
Yeah.
When I travel, I'm hoping that I can impart some sort of knowledge onto somebody, and it's a mutual exchange, and they're handing. I always feel like maybe I learn much more than I can have to offer. And I think that so much of poverty around the world stems from a lack of access to information.
Yep.
And by having an exchange between different cultures, different communities, different people, more information is shared, more options for growing in terms of varieties and techniques and strategies are shared, I think that's ultimately can make a really big impact on poverty.
Yeah, I mean, I would totally agree, and that's why I love visiting places like, you know, visiting you and learning from you, learning from what you're doing here, and being able to, more importantly, share this with you guys. And maybe people in countries around the world are going to watch this video and learn some of the techniques that literally could increase your food production and, you know, and just make the world a better place and share amongst each other. You know, I mean, with GMO foods, they want to have these trade secrets that's not shared because a corporation could get rich. But I'm all for, like, open sourcing all the information about gardening and telling people, you know, how to do it the best way, what we've learned and have you tried and then learn from you. I mean, I'm sure I shared a few things with you that you probably never knew because I've learned on different my travels and journeys, and I've definitely learned things from you. So we've definitely had an exchange here, so I want to thank you for that. I think we're getting to the end of this episode, Josh, but I really want to impart something that's really important to me is getting, aside from, you know, I it's great that you want to impact the world globally and people all over the world, but let's talk about the local food system and, you know, people here in the area and how you literally, by you know, being the garden manager here, can help local people in Orlando or Tampa. You know, it's kind of like you're halfway between both, right? I looked at the map when I was driving here. It was pretty far from Tampa, but I'm like, this is totally one of the best, you know, uses of my day to come out here and spend a day with you and learn this stuff and share. So you want to talk about that?
Sure. So, yeah, a lot of people, they want to dream really big, and I think what I'm trying to do is dream really small, which is just if I can make one small impact on one person by just sharing one cutting or one, you know, piece of information tomorrow, that's good for me, you know, is just making a small impact wherever we can every day, and ultimately believing that adds up to something substantial. So I'm really trying to invest in the community here in Florida by making information available, by giving people tours, by sharing plants, believing that ultimately will add up to a better Florida, you know, or a better world. I'm trying to network with lots of people here in the state. We have a great group in Orlando Permaculture, that's making a lot of this stuff more mainstream in our area, trying to partner with groups like that, hosting workshops, doing whatever we can to make this information available to people here.
Wonderful. Yeah, I mean, that's the same reason why I make my videos, to make the world a better place. I mean, my videos probably, well, on some levels, reach more people than people coming here or do, but, you know, there's no substitute for some of the rare genetics that you have here that you make available in terms of plants, cuttings, or coming to buy nursery plants or giving people's tours. You know, it's totally amazing. So I definitely applaud you for that as well. So, Josh, if somebody wants to come visit here, maybe get a tour, maybe have a, like, in-trade work day, be a volunteer, go through the program, you know, anything, how would they get a hold of you, or who would they get a hold of, and how would that all work?
Sure. So I'm kind of notoriously hard to get a hold of because I'm not great on doing emails and stuff like that. But if you send a message to our office, if you're wanting to come shop at our nursery or volunteer or just get a tour, we do lots of tours. You can bring a group or, you know, it's a very open place. It's a community here. We want everybody to feel welcome as long as we have time, you know, that week. We try to take the time of day to show everybody around if they want to come here. So there's a lot of ways to get plugged in.
Cool. Once again, the link is down below to their website where you will have all the contact information so you can contact their office. All right, Josh, so the last question I have for you is, are there any questions that I should have asked you that I didn't, and what would be the answer?
I'm not sure. What's my favorite plant?
What's your favorite plant?
Probably the mulberry tree.
Mulberry tree, why?
Well, it's one of the most delicious berries that you can grow, and it comes from a tree, and there's many, many varieties of all different shapes and sizes and colors. It's very nutritious. It's very tough and easy to grow. There's varieties with really nutritious cooked leafy greens.
Oh, I didn't know that you could eat the leafy
and
greens.
And I did a nutritional analysis and found that the nutrition on those leaves is higher than moringa in a lot of the categories.
Wow. And, but cooked or raw greens?
Steamed or boiled for 10 minutes.
Steamed or boiled, yeah.
Yeah. I don't think raw is such a great idea.
And what variety would that be? What variety?
Well, I tasted a whole bunch, and I named one edible leaf, and it's in our nursery.
All right. So yeah. If you want that edible leaf,
but you
and
know,
it also
can,
produces the fruit, too,
you can
right?
do the same thing. You know,
yeah.
You can just, it's the white mulberry, Morris alba, is the really one with the good leaves. So you can taste different ones, and if you like the...
And they're all edible. But some are more desirable.
As far as I know, yeah. Some are more tender and desirable. And then it's a useful wood. It's great for animal forage. Like the goats love eating the wood. It grows fast. It's the plant that's historically used to make silk in China. You feed the mulberry leaves to silkworms. So, and that whole plant family, the Moraceae, is my favorite family. It's the figs and jackfruits and breadfruits and all their relatives. So that's my favorite plant.
Wow, cool. And so what kind of mulberry, if somebody wants to have like year-round mulberries, what are the best cultivars for this area for year-round mulberries? Because I know some, like I have a mulberry that fruits like once a year, but I know they have ever-bearing mulberries, and some are more desirable than others, or are all the ever-bearings maybe not so interesting in taste and flavor?
Those ever-bearing ones haven't really panned out to be ever-bearing here. They to really make one big flush, and then you get a couple here and there the rest of the year. But in terms of my favorite variety, just period...
Yeah.
There's these elongated forms. There's a number of varieties, Himalayan, Pakistan, White Pakistan or White Himalayan, and then I have this new one called Skinner.
Oh, really?
Which, if I lay it on my palm, it hangs off both sides. It's like, you know, this long. It's huge.
Yeah, I think some of the ones I grew this year were like Pakistan, and they're wider than my hand. I have pictures on Instagram.
And I'm growing now a pink one.
Oh, pink one.
Mm-hmm. I have these Thai varieties that are ultra dwarf with huge fruit, very fruitful. Growing lots of different. I'm just collect them. I really am into the mulberries.
Wow, and then so do you make all the trees available from the cuttings from the plants
so
that you have?
They're in our nursery. Yeah.
Cool. And then you want to talk really quick about the nursery, like how much are the plants, and how would somebody pick them up? Can they just drop in, or they need to call and make an appointment?
Yeah, it's preferable that people call and make an appointment because it's a kind of a small operation here, and we got a lot of things going on. So you can call or email and set up a nursery appointment and come out. And we're trying to make a little money, but also get the plants out into the community affordably. So most things in a nursery are $10 or less. There's a couple things in bigger pots that might be more, but pretty much anything you can get for $10. And then we also have cuttings and all sorts of things available on the farm. Sometimes we sell banana pups or sugarcane cuttings, things like that.
Wonderful. Great. Well, I've had a great time here, so thanks for taking the time to show me around and all that stuff. And for you guys at home that are watching this, if you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. I got lots of thumbs ups next time I'm in Orlando or Tampa. I'll try to come back because, I mean, there's so much stuff I could have filmed here and I didn't even touch like 1/10 of it. But hopefully what you did see, you did learn today was quite valuable for you, as it was for me to spend literally my whole day here. I mean, it's like almost, I don't know, 8 o'clock and I got here at like 2 or something, you know, to share with you guys. And that's really important to me and part of my mission on continuing learning. And one of the sayings I like is from Gandhi, to become a better student, you must become a better teacher, or vice versa. Become a better teacher, you got to become a better student. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on my new upcoming episodes. I come out every 3 to 4, every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll share what we'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Make sure to click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Be sure to share this video with somebody else, some other fruit heads, some other people that you might that might find this video very educational, especially if you live in the Orlando or Tampa area, because all the things that I've shared with you guys in this episode are pretty much, you know, a lot of location-dependent stuff. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teaching you guys all the different ways you guys can grow more food at home. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.